This video is sponsored by Loot Anime. Stay tuned to the end of the video for an unboxing. Last time on Anime America. I have been randomly summoned to a mystical world full of monsters, wizards, and deadly obstacles. This won't be an easy journey for me, but I will become strong enough to save this world from terrible disaster. But first, cookies! It really isn't an adventure without Mocha and his tea time. Chances are you've heard of them if you're an anime fan. Ever since 1989, this manga team has created countless titles we all know and love, such as Chobits, Cardcaptor Sakura, and XXXHolic. One of their earliest works always caught my attention years ago, but I never got around to reading it or watching the series until now. Special thanks to Patreon supporter Alicia Van Horn for requesting this review, as well as supporting our channel. It's because of her I finally have the chance to review one of Clamp's most classic titles, Magic Knight Ray Earth. So it's the early 90s and fantasy worlds are still a thing. In this case, three schools are on a field trip to Tokyo Tower. There's a school dressed in green that excels in academics, a blue school housing some of Japan's wealthiest children, and a red school for other students. Isn't that always the case? There's always that one regular school idolizing the other better schools, wishing they could be them. So far with this theme and art style, it is screaming 90s anime. Well, when one girl from each school randomly bump into each other, a bright light flashes from the sky as we see a mysterious girl wishing for the Magic Knights to save her world. By Magic Knights, she's referring to these girls as they are suddenly summoned to her world of Sephiro. While the girls are freaking out over what's going on, a convenient mage named Clef tells them everything they need to know. Hey there! So, you three have been summoned from your world to save our own, thank you very much. The planet is facing destruction as our princess is being held by the evil priest Sagato, and there are monsters everywhere endangering our people. You three are totally cool with facing monsters and perilous dangers for our sake, right? Well, awesome, Kate, thanks. Now here are some powers. And now I shall tell you more before the plot conveniently stops me. Too late! You got all that right. So now our three heroes, Hikaru Shido, Umi Ryuzaki, and Fu Hoji, must work together to save Sephiro and the Princess Emerald. They must travel across the land searching for the magical weapons and the legendary rune gods in order to do this task while avoiding all of Sagato's minions. First of all, 90s. 90s, 90s, 90s. Hello 90s hairstyle, hello over-the-top 90s fantasy armor, hello Wendy Lee!
What kind of a place is this?
Okay, just had to get that out of my system. Secondly, I'm only going to cover the first season in this review as there's a lot to talk about, but I do plan to review season 2 shortly after this one. I have to say, compared to the other works, you can tell this is an early work. It's a very simple story that's easy enough to follow without too many complications. That and for a fantasy adventure, these girls have it pretty easy for them. With certain shows like Inuyasha, where we are left at the edge of our seats wondering how our heroes are going to get out of certain situations without dying, in Rayearth's situation, the adventure is formulaic, predictable, and easy for our heroes. They're following a trail to their next objective. Oh no, a monster or villain has stopped them in their tracks. With sheer will, determination, luck, and sometimes Furio, our heroes win the fight and return to their nice accommodations filled with food and soft beds. Don't they just have it lucky? Come on, even Kagome had to use a sleeping bag while the others slept on the dirt or something, but these girls, they get first-class treatment. Hell, their whole adventure is pretty easy thanks to the almighty power of Deus Ex Machina. You see what I did there? Machina makes his first time appearance as the girls' guide. He knows exactly where to take them and provides them everything they need for their trip. Isn't that just convenient? Screw finding maps or asking around for direction. This little guy is gonna give them everything they need for their trip. Are they sure they're traveling through Sephiro or Sephora? Am I right? Another thing that adds to the 90s flair is the typical tomboy hero. Like in Sailor Moon, where Usagi was aided by a group of girls who were better than her in a lot of ways, but she's still their leader, Magic Knight Ray Earth has that as well for Hikaru. Sure, the show mostly features the three of them working together on their quest, but there are some cases focusing on Hikaru's character arc. She met Umi and Fu, admiring how smart and beautiful they are compared to her. Plus, she comes from a traditional background learning kendo, so she doesn't have the same luxuries as the others do. Even though she comes from a simple background, is the shortest girl, and isn't as smart or pretty like them, the show builds her up as a more determined hero who will do everything she can to protect the other two no matter what. Not to mention, the name of the show matches her assigned rune god's name. Fu has Wyndham, Umi has Celeste, and Hikaru gets Ray Earth. This signifies what a lot of female-centered shows do, which has a simple girl you can relate to being the center of attention. She's just like you in many ways, and she's having an amazing adventure. Don't you wish you could be just as lucky? It's just something I noticed with her character type, but compared to other shows, this at least tries harder to keep the team's spirit alive. It isn't just about Hikaru and her struggles. We get to know Fu and Umi very well, as there was equal attention spread out. As for the villains, they're mostly generic 90s villains. Zagato is the leader, and his followers equally want a chance to destroy the Magic Knights. Alcyone betrayed Clef because she fell in love with Zagato and wants to look good in his eyes.
Notice me, senpai.
Inova is Zagato's right-hand man, whom I assume was more than that before I saw the ending to this show.
I beg you for permission to go and face them and finally defeat them once and for all.
No, you're my husbando, and I don't want to lose you.
Then explain our guy love. That's all it is. Guy love. He's mine, I'm his.
But yeah, it's really not like that at all. My mind goes places. Then there's this annoying brat who keeps blaming the Magic Knights for killing his friends, even though he sends them out in the first place to kill them.
But you wouldn't understand having friends like mine. They're special creatures to me. Like all the ones you killed before, but you just don't care at all.
Well, if they were really your friends, you wouldn't send them out to die in the first place, that would you? And then there's Caldina, an assassin only swearing loyalties to Zagato for her own gain, while also caring for Ascot. Zagato at first came off as a bland villain, who, like any other 90s villain, just stood around sending his minions to do all the dirty work. His motives, on the other hand, well, let's just go into spoiler territory now. Skip to this time frame to avoid spoilers. So, note to self, I should seriously do a top 10 list featuring anime plot twists. And boy, does this show have a good one. The whole point of the girl's quest was to rescue the princess from the evil Zagato. That was technically true, but for a different reason. Princess Emerald is the world's beacon of hope. She was solely chosen to protect her world using pure prayers. In exchange, however, she can't allow herself to have her own life. Everyone in Sephiroth will live their own lives in peace and harmony, but Emerald has to sit around and pray for peace with her pure heart. This was all fine and dandy for her at first until, you guessed it, she fell in love with Zagato. Now, with her thoughts being impure, the world began to decay and fill with monsters. So, all of this was her fault. And she actually summons the Magic Knights to put an end to the world's source of decay, meaning they have to kill her. Really? And all this time, Zagato was sending his minions to kill the Knights because he didn't want her to die. And as her girls get their rune gods and kill Zagato, they soon realize what they really have to do. Hello?
Why the f*** didn't you tell them, Clef?
Yeah, they really couldn't know the truth from the very beginning, or else, well, who would really want to go on a magical quest to kill a princess? All this time, they're on their magic quest to save the princess as they praise her for being such a great person, only to find out that they have to kill her. Time is running out and her sorrow over losing Zagato turned her into a vengeful queen, so either the girls refuse to kill her and watch Sephiroth crumble, or save Sephiroth and kill the princess. I'm sure you know what they have to do, but after the deed is done, they're sent back to the very second they disappeared from Tokyo, as if nothing ever happened. So, girls, how was your day? You three okay over there? So even though I give this show a hard time for being an easy quest for our girls, the twist at the end was brilliant. It came out of nowhere and took me by surprise, so it was all worth it in the end. For starting off as a simple story dripping in 90s flair, it took an interesting turn down a dark path for our girls, and it's something they have to carry in the next season. Like I said, this review is only covering the first season, but I can review season 2 if you're interested. With such a nice finish to this season, I am interested to see what's next. And now Now on to the other things in Magic Knight Ray Earth, the animation. It was actually done by one of the oldest animation studios, Tokyo Movie Shinsha, who's done a lot of incredible work like Akira, Lupin the Third, and a lot of Detective Conan films. While this is an incredible studio with a great history in animation, this is one of their weakest works. The animation is constantly inconsistent, and not because of the chibi transitions. There are times when the proportions are really off and their eyes look very weird. Voice acting from way back when is better compared to some other dubs for the time period. However,
you stockpiled all of these weapons, but they're not for a revolt against Lord Zagato? If y'all kill those strangers out there, I won't tell Lord Zagato. Is that any way to greet someone? Especially someone who looks as magnificent as I'm looking today.
Hey, wait a sec. Doesn't she have a southern accent?
Did someone tell Lenore Zan to try and sound like Cree Summers? Or just a black southern stereotype? I know this was dubbed a long time ago and all, but this was just uncomfortable for me. Oh, 90s. If you want to own the series, Ride Stuff Anime has got you covered. There's not really any legal sites for you to watch this online, so you're just gonna have to rely on Google search if you really want to try to watch this first online. Like I said, Ride Stuff Anime has the DVD if you want to add this to your collection. I'd say this is a harmless classic from the 90s with a really good twist at the end of season 1. So I'd say, if you're in the mood for a girl-powered fantasy show, definitely check out Magic Knight Ray Earth.
It's your time. Come on, grab your friends. We'll go to very distant lands.
Do I have a dog? And why is dog no come protect me?
How you doing?
Fabulous secrets were revealed to me the day I held aloft my sword and said, "For the honor of Grayskull, I am She-Ra."
You best stay out of my way, bitch, or you gonna be dead.
What if I'm, like, stealing gold in my sleep?
You can't be stealing gold in your sleep. I watch you while you sleep.
What?
Hey there, bitches.
Oh, he's so cute. He's so cute. I wish he would go to hell and die. He's so cute.
What you made me do, look what you made me do, look what you just made me do, look what you just made me do.
We rescued Wildberry Princess from the Ice King.
I just wanna be happy.
Y'all need Jesus.
Once again, this video has been sponsored by Loot Anime. The theme for this box is spirits, and it features some nice teacups from Mushishi, a pretty good figurine from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, an amazing art book from the famous artist Yoshitaka Amano, a origami pin, a Loot Anime Yume phone charm, and this poster, which provides all the merchandise you should have gotten in your box on the back. Next month's theme will be Besties, which will feature merchandise from Madoka Magica, One Piece, The Seven Deadly Sins, and K-On! If you're interested in getting this box, just click on the link down below and use the code word ANIMEAMERICA to get a nice discount off of your first box.
Whee!
Thanks everybody for watching our review. If you wish to keep up to date with Anime America events, be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Twitter, Instagram, and even Tumblr. If you want to support this channel, be sure to click on the notification bell to keep up with our video uploads, as well as liking this video and sharing it on any social media platform you choose. If you wish to support us financially, we have a Patreon page with numerous rewards to fit your budget, as well as sell posters on Store Envy and t-shirts on Teespring. Don't forget to subscribe to Anime America for more awesome reviews and top 10 lists. We also have a sister channel called Pop Spectrum, where we review anything in pop culture. Thanks again for watching, and stay tuned to Anime America.